Tiffany Turner was living a full and active life as wife, teacher, author, and musician when she experienced a life-threatening heart crisis. On the Move host Donna Yeager learned about the timely events before surgery and after her recovery. Now we will visit with Tiffany Turner and her mom, Sharon Peck, with our On the Move host, Donna Yeager.
Hi, I'm Donna Yeager with On the Move, and I'd like to welcome our very special guest, Tiffany Turner. Welcome, Tiffany.
Thank you for having me.
And welcome, Sharon Peck.
Thank you.
Welcome. Now, Tiffany, I'd like to start by asking you, you had basically a pretty average and interesting childhood, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I grew up here in the Silicon Valley.
That's great. Wonderful. And then so when you were, you had the normal types of colds though, right?
Yeah, I would get, you know, sick sometimes. I did get a lot more colds and had allergy problems. Yeah. At that time, the Silicon Valley had a lot of orchards
and we
had a lot of pollen in the air, and we still kind of have a lot here because of it. But, you know, I noticed that I would get kind of sick a lot, but I thought not as bad as normal or like anybody else.
Right.
And then I got a lot of colds, and I even got bronchitis and pneumonia when I was in college.
Oh, okay, okay. But was that locally, or did you go to college?
I went to San Jose State, actually.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. That's also where I got my teaching degree.
Oh, wow.
My teaching credential.
Fantastic. That's great. So, and then were you, when did you start teaching, actually?
In 1997.
Wow.
The last century.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
That's great.
And I've been teaching up until everything recently, of course, happened to me last year.
But then you got married, though. When did you get married?
Oh, 2003.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I married an Englishman.
Oh, great.
Yeah, and I hung out a lot in Sunnyvale at one of the British pubs, where a lot of the engineers in the area hang out, of course.
Oh, that's cool. That's great. And he's been very supportive of your
I didn't, with everything that happened, I didn't know I was really upsetting my family as much. And of course, he was by my side the whole time, and so was my mom.
Yeah.
So, you know, they were both by me all the time when all this was going on.
Right,
so he's
exactly.
been very supportive.
Well, and actually, I want to ask Sharon how it actually happened, because you don't remember too much of it.
No.
So you thought that it was just a cold.
I thought basically I had bronchitis really bad. Yeah. It was beginning of December.
Right.
And, you know, Christmas is coming. The kids get really hyper.
Right.
And there's a lot of energy drawn from
right.
me.
Yeah.
You know, I was feeling fatigue and sick.
Yeah. Right.
I closed my classroom door thinking I'd pick it over the weekend.
Yeah, right.
And then I remember waking up in the hospital with a trach tube down my
throat.
My throat.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then, you know, my mom has had to fill me in because they had to sedate me.
Right,
so
right.
she pretty much has told me a lot of the things that I missed because I was sedated during the time.
So, Sharon, how did you actually find out about it?
Well, she went to the doctor. We knew she wasn't feeling well, and she was going to go in to see the doctor.
Yeah.
But when she got there, they suggested that she go into the emergency room, to the hospital. So her husband took her in.
Yeah.
And when she was there, you know, they were monitoring her, and the first night, she had a difficult night, and so they moved her up to ICU, but they were treating her with antibiotics for the pneumonia, because they had decided she had pneumonia. And she was moved into the ICU, and I had gone to visit her that morning, and she was, you know, getting used to the whole idea of being in the hospital, but not real thrilled. She was worried about her classroom, as most teachers are.
I was still doing my lesson plans, too.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
And so she just didn't realize how sick she was. No one did. And later on in the afternoon, there was an event that happened, and she lost consciousness. Her husband was there, and according to the all the equipment, you know, the alarms went off and everything, and she had a heart attack.
Uh-huh.
And the recorded equipment showed that her heart had stopped for about a minute. And they were able to resuscitate her.
Uh-huh.
And by the time we came to the hospital that night, they were telling us how really, really sick she was, that her, there was fluid in her lungs.
Yeah.
And that there had been a problem with her heart. And so it was, you know, a long night. They were doing lots and lots of tests. And they were giving her different kinds of antibiotics, trying to exactly find out what had happened to her.
Wow.
And it took a long, long time. We finally got a test back at around midnight that night, telling us that, and the doctor said she had a blood clot inside of her heart.
Ooh.
And so this was another complication that they hadn't realized, and was so then, you know, they continued treating her, and luckily she did start to respond and get better.
Wow. Good.
But it took a long time. She was in ICU for 8 days.
Oh, wow.
And
she
was unconscious during that time.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, but they did a wonderful job of taking care of
her. Yeah, I'm really, really glad with the hospital and what they did for me, and the doctors especially.
And your husband took turns, right? Both of you.
Yes, we took turns going to see her, and someone was there all the time.
Wow.
As much as we could be there.
Yeah.
And
when I woke up, it was my mom that actually that I saw, and I had the trach tube down my throat, and I looked at her, and I saw her face, and I realized, oh man, this really got bad, because I was trying to remember what had happened to me, and I could only remember me closing the door in my classroom, because the sedatives had wiped my memory of all going to the hospital, being checked in, going code blue and everything, so that's my last memory I actually had before everything happened.
Scary, really scary. Gosh.
Yeah.
Well, and it was kind of interesting because we met a couple of days ago, and you said that you were able to take a selfie. in the hospital bed. That's pretty amazing.
I realized that, you know, I this was something big that had happened to me, and I wanted to kind of show it. Plus, I also wanted to talk to my friends on Facebook, and actually they. Were talking to me back, and it was like a lifeline in the hospital with my friends to be able to talk to them like that.
That's great.
Yeah, and you know, I was humorous about it. You know, I was making jokes. I got a test done, and I think they had to put some radiation in me to see different organs.
Oh my
God. Everybody's saying, oh, you're like Spider-Man, you know, you've been bit by a spider. I'm like, yeah. So we were going around calling me Spider Tiff for a while.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, you have to keep your humor when these things happen.
Exactly. Very important. It really helps, you know?
Yeah, it does.
Because you weren't able to have visitors.
Not for the people in the ICU, when I was in ICU.
Right.
But when I actually got to the regular hospital room, all my friends started coming and seeing me. And they saw it on Facebook and they're like, oh my goodness, what happened?
Wow.
And so I had a lot of friends actually come see me in the hospital when they were allowing visitors.
Yeah.
That was the best support, was seeing all my friends come in and seeing how he's doing and making jokes. And it really helped me get through the beginnings of everything that happened.
Yeah. Because it's, Sharon, it's pretty rare, right?
Yes, what happened to her was pretty rare. The doctors had not seen something like that, where the blood clot was inside the heart.
Wow.
And it was a pretty good size blood clot, too.
Wow. Yeah.
So I'm just grateful that they were able to find it and figured out what was going on with her.
Wow.
And were able to eventually treat it.
Yeah. So there was like a blood clotting, or what do you call it, anticoagulant or something?
It was a blood clot in my actual chamber, behind one of the valves. It was in the chamber, and they were trying the arteries and did tests, but, you know, they couldn't actually do an operation or anything.
Yeah.
So they had to put me on warfarin for, you know, as long as till they could get the blood clot to break down.
And so it thinned the blood, right?
It thinned it, yeah. And they had to regulate. I had to go in once a week, and my mom was taking me. I didn't drive for a little bit after this.
It took several months for that blood clot to dissolve.
Wow.
But luckily it did.
Oh,
yeah.
Good.
There's, you know, we were really worried if it didn't help, what would happen, because there isn't really an operation.
Wow. Because it was in a difficult area, right?
Yeah, in the actual heart chamber.
Woo, that's amazing. Really incredible, my gosh. But you stayed on the move the whole time.
Yeah. I mean, as much as I could. I had a physical therapist coming in and helping me at first. She was doing home visits, and she had me do special exercises, lifting my, mostly lifting my feet off the couch and just basic movements to get some strength back. She had me move to standing movements.
Because you liked your bicycle.
Oh, yeah.
You missed your bicycle.
That was one of my goals, was to get back on my bike, because I love hiking. I love biking, and I wasn't going to, like, just spend my whole time on the couch anymore. I wanted to work towards it, but my
body... Well, it's good to have a goal, you know. It was important.
It was really helpful having a goal going through all this. And each time I reached a goal, I would set another goal to keep me going.
That's good. Yeah. Well, and one really neat one that I really liked was the... Your garden. You have a garden, community garden.
Yeah,
that you like. And I guess you asked Mom and your husband to keep an eye on it while you're in the hospital.
Yes. Well, luckily it was December, so you know, at that time of the year, you're not really planning.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, and so a lot of it, you know, you want to turn the earth and everything, so it was a little later this year, but my mom did a lot of that at the very beginning. Our community garden plot is actually together.
Oh, cool.
Yeah,
so her goal was, one of her goals was to be able to go to the garden, you know, just being able to get out there. Right. And there aren't a lot of, you know, it's all dirt. So we had to figure out how she would be able, because at that point, she was still using a walker.
Oh, yeah.
But we managed to make that work. We got out there, and she was able to be in the garden. And
I wanted to plant some seeds in the ground.
Plant some seeds in the spring, she was able
but
to plant.
Actually, the walker was pretty cool, because it actually had a seat that you could sit down.
Yeah, actually.
Because you did tire easily. Mm-hmm. So you needed to be able to sit and rest.
Exactly.
Yeah, one of the first things I did in the walker was go out and see Rick Steves.
Oh, yeah.
Who was at the Travel Channel. They were having one of their conventions.
Yeah.
I went to go see him talk.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. So I even got an autograph from him, too.
I know. He's a really neat guy.
Yeah. I love the travel, so it was really good to see him in person.
It was fun.
It was a good experience. We had never really done anything like that. And thinking about how she could manage to do that, you know, and but she was using the walker at the time.
Right.
And the physical therapist said, you know, bring the walker and just use it to rest. So wherever we, whenever she was tired, she would just be able to sit down and rest.
Exactly.
And so we could pace ourselves through the day that way.
Yeah.
It worked.
And also, was it your physical therapist? They told you about the food, the special preparation.
Actually, my husband saw that on Alice Radio, and I think it was the producer, actually is friends with one of the people, and so they actually were talking about it.
Oh, okay.
And so he thought he'd try ordering Blue Apron and seeing how that would work. And so with him working and me not really being able to make food or cook and stuff, get groceries.
That's the hardest part. Yeah.
Going to the grocery store was one of the hardest things for her. So,
it's very tiring for able-bodied people, let alone, you know, you got to fight through the aisles.
Exactly.
Yeah, the lifting is really hard, too, and just putting all the items and pushing it around.
Right.
I mean, the cart helps you kind of stay up and walk, but it's just more physically harder to do all that. I mean, I've just gone back to grocery shopping now, but it's light. I can't do heavy amounts.
Right, exactly. Yeah.
And it's taken a lot. It's taken several months just to get this far.
A little at a time.
Yeah, I was using Instacart, actually, to get a lot of my groceries.
Yeah, good.
Yeah, so that helped a lot.
Yeah, definitely.
I found different ways that I could help myself and still keep, you know, the household running.
Exactly, that's good. And you're still doing physical therapy, right?
I'm on phase 3.
Okay.
I did phase 1 and with Diana, my physical therapist. And she got me to the point where I could ride on a bike and I could do a couple of laps around my complex.
Right.
I couldn't do the trails yet, but at least I could get on the bike.
Right.
That was
actually
the fun part.
Actually, you know what? I forgot. I didn't go into the part where we really need to make people realize that women have different symptoms than men do.
Yeah.
So Sharon, maybe tell us what some of those symptoms are.
Well, I know that with Tiffany, she was very dizzy and fatigued. And those were two signs that were happening to her that she didn't realize was maybe leading up to this.
Wow.
And the doctors are telling her now, you know, those were things that she was experiencing. extreme fatigue. She thought it was because, you know, she was the beginning of the school year and it's always a busy time.
Right.
And that, you know, she had been a little bit stressed and maybe thought that was part of
the
it.
The teachers are always tired, you know. We always are fatigued.
So she wasn't realizing some of these things could have been a sign.
And I was having shortness of breath. Sometimes I was breathing through my mouth more, a little more out of breath.
Yeah.
And I'd be like going a little faster and then I'd be... And I thought, oh, I'm just getting old. But I was only 46.
Yeah,
I'm 47 now, but still that's not considered, you know, too old.
Right, exactly. And I thought that there was another coughing, you said.
Yeah, and also coughing. It would be kind of like the out of breath. I would do stuff and I'd start coughing too. Mm-hmm. I mean, like that.
Right.
And I just would think, you know, maybe I'm coming down with another cold or something.
Yeah.
So her lungs were really affected by all this that had happened to her.
Yeah.
And they're telling us now that the heart and the lung worked together. And so some of these symptoms that were happening in her lungs could have been caused as part of her heart condition.
As congestive heart failure.
Mm-hmm. Oh, my gosh. That's amazing, huh? Well, so cooking, like we said, is very important.
Mm-hmm.
And you have received certificates for your love of writing also.
Oh,
right?
Yes.
that's
been almost another therapy in itself, just to keep my mind from going kind of crazy.
Yeah.
I could sit on, you know, if I got really tired, I could sit on the couch and do some writing for an hour.
Right,
And be really productive. And so I've actually written three children's books.
Yeah.
And done some romance writing. So just getting back into writing and doing that has really helped a lot.
And actually, that's where I met you first.
Yes.
You were at a beautiful crafts fair, and I love arts and crafts, and I love jewelry. So I had a lot of fun meeting you, and I bought a couple earrings.
Yeah,
they were just too gorgeous. Yeah, way too gorgeous.
Thank you.
And I really had a lot of fun with it. And the crystals actually tie into some of your kids' books, your children's books. So that was really fun.
Yeah, the main character actually wears a crystal pendant. She works with the fairies and tries to help them come over problems. And the first book is all about them trying to work with the problem of pollution.
Exactly.
And now they're trying to help with that.
Right. But we also, when we met with you, you told us about your amazing love and talent at playing, I forgot the first name of the harp.
Gaelic harp.
Gaelic harp.
Yeah.
It is heaven. Like, would you please play some music?
Oh, sure. I'd love to.
Thank you.
And this is what it looks like. The first one I'm going to play is called Brian Boru's March.
Okay.
It's
cool.
A Irish song.
Okay. Thank you.
That's the first one. I can also play for you a clan tune.
Okay.
A lot of the different Scottish families and Irish families have a song just for their families. And so they'd use it in going into battle and rallying, you know, for the battle cry when they would go into battle. So this one is called Parson's Farewell. For the family Parsons, of course.
Okay.
And then the last one I'll play is called Rondo. It's a Renaissance tune.
Okay. Beautiful.
Thank you.
Oh my gosh. That sends chills up my spine. So beautiful.
Yeah, I do enjoy playing that at fair.
Yeah, you were at the Renaissance Fair.
Yeah, I do work at the Northern Renaissance Fair. Right,
and we have a photograph of you when you were sitting on your walker, relaxing and playing it for people. And oh, it's just so beautiful.
Yeah, that was at the Sonora Celtic Festival. So I do a lot of different fairs throughout Northern California. But I really wanted to get back into doing fair.
Yeah.
And that was one thing, having fair. Northern Fair is actually in September.
Oh, wow.
So I had to work really hard because this all happened in December to get back to a physical ability to be able to do fair. And that was one thing that I really wanted to do. And that helped having that as a goal so much.
That's great. Wonderful. Well, also, Sharon, you are so amazing. And you're helping your daughter out and kind of juggling. You're doing a heck of a lot.
Yeah, yeah.
Because your kids, your grandkids.
Yeah, I have grandchildren as well. So I kind of divide my time and, you know, with her and then spend time with them too as well.
Yeah. Well, you know, family support is so important.
Right.
And it's wonderful that you're so, you know, helpful. And it was really a lot of fun meeting both of you guys to see you at the crafts fair because you were a good team together.
Yeah, that's true. Takes teamwork to get
exactly.
it done.
And I mean, physically, it's exhausting because you have to, you know, set everything up when you get there. And then usually it's 1 or 2 days, right? So you have to, you know, make sure everything's running smoothly at the booth.
That's true.
Yeah, that's true. Or we tag team too. Yeah. So it's good to have another person.
It's good to have
you.
A partner when
exactly,
you're doing all that.
Right. It's very important. Well, actually, can you tell me what your address, your website is for the books?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, sure. The Crystal Keeper Chronicles can be found at crystalkeeper.wordpress.com.
Okay, great. And also, I want to tell people that if they're interested in finding out more about the American Heart Association, they can go to www.heart.org/life.
Yeah.
And they can learn more information about, you know, they can send you literature regarding some of the possible, what do we call those?
Cardiomyopathy is what I have.
Oh, wow.
So I actually went to that website and it did help a lot to kind of learn what I have now, because that's one thing I had to do is, you know, learn a lot about what has happened to me.
Mm-hmm.
And then Barbara Streisand has a heart center that is in Hollywood, I think West Hollywood or Hollywood. And that also, that website also has a lot of good information too.
Oh, cool. That's good. So maybe people just put Barbara Streisand's name.
I think the Barbara Streisand Heart Center and all the information comes up if you search for it.
Good, thank you. That's very good. Now, actually, Sharon, we want to talk a little bit more about the idea of what people should kind of look for if something is kind of different with, you know, people if they're feeling weak or tired. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What should they look for?
Well, again, the shortness of breath and dizzy spells, which is something that I didn't know.
Yeah.
But the doctor said that was something that might have been for her. She had some dizzy spells.
A red
didn't
flag.
Realize. Yeah, that was a red flag.
Yeah, I had a lot of vertigo when I was on vacation in Germany, and they actually put me into a hospital for a little bit because I was so nauseated, I was throwing up and getting dizzy and almost falling down.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, so I was hospitalized there for 4 days. And then now my cardiologist says it might have been a mini stroke too.
Ooh, wow.
Yeah, so that one thing is just if you see those symptoms happening to you, there's even tests that they can do.
Yeah.
And just to see, even doing an ultrasound, just to see if there's a clot or something in your heart, you know, if you suspect it.
Okay.
But, you know, if you're having a lot of fatigue and you're feeling really stressed, and so many people are going through that, you know, just check with your doctor.
Especially during the holidays.
Right.
Yeah.
You're on warp speed, you know.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
And we all are. I mean, I think Silicon Valley is just that way, and you're not.
Yeah.
True.
You don't realize how crazy, you know, living here is.
always pushing yourself and pushing. And I mean, that's the one thing. Teachers, we always push. We're always going, you know, first sick, you know, we're pulling ourselves out of bed and going to work and teaching the kids. And then I think that's part of it is that, you know, when you're pushing yourself like that, you're not really realizing what's happening is something, you know, whether it's not bronchitis, you know, I just didn't expect it. I thought it was fatigue from being teaching, you know, and teaching takes a lot of energy out of you too.
And the kids, I mean, the kids really suffer because they miss you.
They did miss me. I did go back on the last day to see them because I mean, I missed them too, but I had to get physically good, you know, my strength back. I had to get my strength back to go see them.
I'm just
thankfully got it back in time. I was on using the cane by then and got to see them, and I had little posse around me that was kind of following me around, and I had lunch with them. So, and it was good to say goodbye to them. Have a little closure. Yeah, I was really sad I didn't get to do all the things in the second part of the year with them, but I was their teacher for half the year.
That's right. And I'm sure they appreciated that.
They did.
Okay, so tell me one more time what's your website is.
It's crystalkeeper.wordpress.com. And they'll find The Lost Secret of Fairies, The Lost Secret of the Green Man, and The Lost Secret of Dragonfire.
Okay.
And I all there. And I'm also working on the fourth book, The Lost Secret of Time.
Oh, cool.
Which is
great,
because I'm using this time to get better also to write, too.
Good.
Which, you know, people say writing is a therapy in itself.
Right. Well, I want to also say the website for the Heart Association, American Heart Association. It's www.heart.org/life. Mm-hmm. Tiffany, I want to thank you so very much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
And Sharon, thank you.
Thank you for having us.
So we'll keep in touch, okay?
Oh, yes.
Thank you. Thanks. And thank you so very much for joining us. Until next time, I'm Donna Yeager with On the Move. Have a wonderful day. Happy holidays.
Got it.
If you see us in your businesses or see us on TV, don't be surprised, because you'll see us there again.
And again.
Because we're showing our abilities and building self-esteem. We're going places that we've never been.
Hey, we're on the move to make this world a better place. We're on the move, we're striking out to save the face. We all can choose to make a difference. We're on the move to make this world a better place. We're on the move, we're striking out to set the pace. We all can choose to make a difference. Our time is overdue if we collect our dreams, take them on the move. If we collect our dreams, take them on the move. So let's pick up our dreams, take them on the move.